योगः कर्मसु कौशलम्।
Namaskar, I am Dr. Jagdish Joshi, Professor and Director of UGC Human Resource Development Center of Gujarat University, Ahmedabad. I am very happy to welcome you to this first of its kind online refresher course in English language teaching. I would like to welcome and introduce the resource person of today. Yes, that's what I do always. And today's resource person is a proficient personality, Dr. Nirja A. Gupta. She is a principal of Bhavans Sheth R.A. College of Arts and Commerce, Ahmedabad. She is also a director of Study Abroad Program and Diaspora Research Center of Gujarat University, Ahmedabad. She is a member of Board of Governance of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Open University, Ahmedabad. She is also a syndicate member of Gujarat University, Ahmedabad. She is in the field of teaching and research for last 33 years. She knows 8 languages. To name them, Hindi, English, Sanskrit, Gujarati, Russian, Assami, Marathi and Urdu. She is a recipient of Shiksha Bharati Puraskar in 2011 and Atal Bihari Vajpayee National Award in 2017 for contribution in diaspora studies. She has at her credit 15 books, mainly by international publishers like Cambridge, London, Bhavans, Mappin and more. She has about 50 research articles at her credit. At present on the panel of several international and Indian universities, she contributes regularly. She is on the panel of commissions, academic and administrative bodies of several universities and government bodies. She is supervisor for USIEF and Indian Institute for American Studies. She has widely traveled in India and abroad. She has visited about 36 countries, including Russia, Britain, Australia, Canada, Minsk, Uzbekistan, Malaysia, Finland, Belgium, Spain, Germany, France, Indonesia, Thailand, Abu Dhabi, Algeria, Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, Belarus, Bulgaria, Austria, Turkey, Oman, Dubai, Singapore, Hong Kong, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bangladesh, Egypt, Burma, Brunei, Mauritius, Fiji and Japan. She is going to talk on teaching modern English poetry. Ma'am, I welcome you here to talk on teaching modern poetry.
Thank you so much, Dr. Joshi, for such a profuse introduction of mine and for inviting me to deliver this segment in this new NRC module. I would like to talk about the teaching of modern English poetry in this segment, which might be slightly different from what we understand teaching modern English poetry. I know when we say teaching poetry, one may question, what exactly? Because poetry is such a vast genre that we can start anything from the father of the English poetry, Chaucer, till date whatever been written today in the various continents, in various spaces, in various nuances. We have been teaching modern poetry in the colleges with the major modern poets. Of course, modernism as a major movement of English poetry, but still I found that there are certain issues which need to be talked about intricately with the faculty members. So for today, the major session would be modern English poetry with some minor and major poets. We all know that not all contemporary poetry is considered modern in the sense of the modernist literary movement. The modernist poets such as T.S. Eliot tended to favor intellect over emotion and valued themes of alienation and isolation as reactions to the romanticism of the previous era of literature. For contemporary poetry, common trends include the stream of consciousness, free verse, and the preference for suggestion or ambiguity of ideas. The modern age has proved inimical to Victorian traditions, as we can gather from the general trends. And modern poetry is essentially the poetry of revolt, we all know. It is not, however, implied that all modern poets have reacted against the older traditions. Not all contemporary poetry is considered modern in the sense of modernist literary movement. The kind of poetry which had begun to show signs of exhaustion and lifelessness, this had included into the modern poetry. The modern age has rightly been called the age of interrogation. For older values in literature, like those in life, have been questioned. The range of diction in modern poetry has been extended, led to include slang words, colloquialisms, and jargon. Passages in John Masefield's poetry mark the limit to which this movement has been carried. The extension of subject matter was even more remarkable. Every subject now is considered capable of poetic treatment. The modern poets have discovered elements of poetry in tram cars and railway trains, locomotives and aeroplanes, the factory and the stock exchange. Like Masefield wrote his songs about the dirt and the dross and dust and the scum of the earth, of the maimed, of the halt and the blind. W.W. Gibson in his songs praised the courage of the man and the machine and described the underworld in mining areas. In spite of his preoccupation with a variety of subjects, the modern poet had not ceased to love nature. Indeed, a deep love for her has found expression in modern poetry. Our poets have widened the bounds of beauty by describing the loveliness of wildness and wet of nature. The poetry of patriotism, of the love of the homeland, of the sea and its defenders has received splendid additions in the modern age. While realism is the avowed aim of many of modern poets, there are others who have tried to escape from the sordid realities into regions of fantasy and imagination. The modern age is an age of disillusionment. The last war shook the foundations of the dream world that the complacent Victorian poets had tried to impose on their readers. One often comes across a mood of pessimism and disillusionment in modern poetry, particularly in the delicately chiseled poems of A.E. Housman and in some of Eliot's poems, such as The Wasteland or The Hollow Men.
The Hollow Men by T.S. Eliot. We are the hollow men, we are the stuffed men, leaning together, headpiece filled with straw, alas. Our dried voices, when we whisper together, are quiet and meaningless, as wind in dry grass, or rat's feet over broken glass, in our dry cellar. Shape without form, shade without colour, paralyzed force, gesture without motion, those who have crossed with direct eyes to death's other kingdom remember us, if at all, not as lost, violent souls, but only as the hollow men, the stuffed men. Eyes I dare not meet in dreams, in death's dream kingdom, these do not appear. There the eyes are, sunlight on a broken column. There is a tree swinging, and voices are, in the wind singing, more distant and more solemn than a fading star. Let me be no nearer, in death's dream kingdom, Let me also wear such deliberate disguises, rat's coat, crow skin, crossed staves, in a field, behaving as the wind behaves, no nearer, not that final meeting in the twilight kingdom. This is the dead land, this is cactus land. Here the stone images are raised, here they receive the supplication of a dead man's hand, under the twinkle of a fading star. Is it like this in death's other kingdom, waking alone, at the hour when we are trembling with tenderness, lips that would kiss, form prayers to broken stone? The eyes are not here, there are no eyes here, in this valley of dying stars, in this hollow valley, this broken jaw of our lost kingdoms, in this last of meeting places, we grope together and avoid speech, gathered on this beach of the tumid river, sightless unless the eyes reappear as the perpetual star, multifoliate rose of death's twilight kingdom, the hope only of empty men. Here we go round the prickly pear, prickly pear, prickly pear. Here we go round the prickly pear at 5 o'clock in the morning. Between the idea and the reality, between the motion and the act, falls the shadow, for thine is the kingdom. Between the conception and the creation, between the emotion and the response, falls the shadow. Life is very long. Between the desire and the spasm, between the potency and the existence, between the essence and the descent, falls the shadow, for thine is the kingdom, for thine is, life is, for thine is the. This is the way the world ends. This is the way the world ends. This is the way the world ends. Not with a bang, but a whimper.
April is the cruelest month, breeding lilacs out of the dead land, mixing memory and desire, stirring dull roots with spring rain. Winter kept us warm, covering earth in forgetful snow, feeding a little life with dried tubers. Ganga was sunken, and the limp leaves waited for rain, while the black clouds gathered far distant over Himavant. The jungle crouched, humped in silence. Then the thunder spoke. Da. Data. What have we given? My friend, blood shaking my heart, the awful daring of a moment's surrender, which an age of prudence can never retract. By this, and this only, we have existed, which is not to be found in our obituaries, or in memories draped by the beneficent spider, or under seals broken by the lean solicitor in our empty rooms. Da. Dyadvam. I have heard the key turn in the door once, and turn once only. We think of the key, each in his prison, thinking of the key. Each confirms a prison only at nightfall. Ethereal rumors revive for a moment a broken Coriolanus. Da. Damyata. The boat responded gaily to the hand expert with sail and oar. The sea was calm. Your heart would have responded gaily when invited, beating obedient to controlling hands. I sat upon the shore fishing with the arid plain behind me. Shall I at least set my lands in order? London Bridge is falling down, falling down, falling down. Poi s'ascosi nel fuoco che gli affina, quando fiam uti che li don. Oh, swallow, swallow. La Prince d'Aquitaine à la tour abolie. These fragments I have shored against my ruins. Why, then, I'll fit you. Hieronymo's mad again. Data, diadvam, damnita. Shanti, shanti, shanti.
One of the outstanding features of modern poetry is humanism. Many modern poets show a passion for humanity and a deep sympathy for all classes of men. John Masefield generally deals sympathetically with the lower classes of people and is their representative poet. The war poetry produced during the years 1914 to 1918 is essentially a glorification of the hero in man. Above have been described, you know, just now, some of the main tendencies in modern poetry and some of the subjects that interest the modern poet. A reaction from the studied perfection of the Victorians is apparent everywhere, and some of the poetry that is being produced is obviously experimental in nature that will not stand the test of time. It is thus possible perhaps to dislike much in modern poetry, but it is hard to doubt the sincerity of the work and art of modern poets. Explanations of poets and era with examples are important here to be cited. I would like to begin with Robert Bridges. He is a poet of transition, bridging the gulf between the Victorians and the moderns. In the time sense, says Ward, he is a Victorian poet in form and spirit. He belongs to future. A cultured country gentleman, he had all a classicist reserve and a dislike of outbursts. He lacked penetration and his range of vision was narrow. He generally dealt with traditional themes and gazed at traditionally poetic objects as a detached spectator. For these reasons, he is as much cried down at present as his friend Gerard Manley Hopkins is glorified. Bridges published his first book of verse in 1873 and his last, The Testament of Beauty, was published in 1929. During this period, he wrote dramas, narratives, masques and pastorals. His dramas such as Nero, The Feast of Bacchus and Return of Ulysses lack somewhat the dynamic essence of humanity. He succeeded best in his lyrics. Even in lyrics, his imagination is not very wide, though the theme is varied. They are lacking in suggestiveness and subtlety, but they are chiseled and polished, like the marbles. Early in his life, Bridges wrote, "I love all beauteous things. I seek and adore them." He is a dignified priest of beauty. To him, all earthly beauty, the beauty that perishes, is but a stepping stone to the heavenly beauty, the beauty that lasts. As he says, all earthly beauty hath one cause and proof to lead the pilgrim soul to beauty above. We go to the second poet, Rudyard Kipling. Kipling has been said that if a poet had written Kipling's verses, they would have been poetry. For a long time, there were two entirely opposite views on Kipling's poetry. By some, he was looked upon as a great genius, as a popular idol, and many people read his verses to whom poetry was otherwise repellent. But there were certain sensitive-minded people to whom his poetry appeared loud and vulgar. They were infuriated by his aggressive imperialism, by his incongruous union of brutality and sentimentality, by his banjo rhythms and excessive use of cockney, soldier speech, By 1925, Kipling had ceased to be either a popular idol or an object of detestation, and his work began to be judged by literary rather than poetical standards. The massive bulk of Kipling's poetry stands in a far way of a fair appreciation of it. For it is unequal quality, there is much admittedly excellent poetry, much of doubtful quality, and much that is definitely inferior. His poetry is contained in several volumes: Barrack Room, Ballads, Departmental Ditties, The Seven Seas, The Five Nations, and The Songs from Books. Who can forget the tire tampling of weary soldiers with befogged minds? Try, 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 try to think of something different. Oh my God, keep me from going lunatic. Showing fine sympathy and insight, he made the common soldier articulate, thus introduced a new element in English poetry. He showed us that soldiers were not mere fighting automatons. We aren't no thin redderers, nor we aren't no blackguards too, but single men in barracks, most remarkable like you. In a poem like Shilling a Day, he spoke of the nation's neglect of the maimed and discharged soldier. The sea poems of Kipling are superb. He glories in the kick of life, the attraction of danger in perilous water. Poems like Last Chantry or The Song of the Dead are among the finest poems in English poetry dealing with the life at sea.
Dreamers dreaming greatly in the mind stifled down. We heard beyond the skyline where the strange roads go down. Came the whisper, came the vision, came the power with a meet till the soul. That's not man's soul. Was lent us to lead. As the steer breaks from the cut where they graze, in the faith of little children, we went on our ways. Then the wood failed. Then the foot failed, then the last water dried. In the faith of little children, we lay down and died. On the sand drift, on the belt side, in the burn scrap we lay. That our sons might follow after by the bones on the way. Follow after. We have water to the root, and the bodies come to blossom. That ripens for fruit. Follow after, we are waiting by the trails that we lost. For the sound of many footsteps, for the tread of a host. Follow after, for the harvest is sown by the bones. While the wayside, you shall come to your own. On the sand drift, on the belt side, in the burn scrap we lay. That our sons might follow after by the bones on the way. Follow after.
follow after. We could water the root, and the bud has come to blossom. That ripens for fruit.
Kipling's nature poetry is not very impressive. Kipling's poetry has little metaphysical interest. What serves as a philosophy of life in his poetry is a conviction that Englishmen ate divinely charged with the duty of enlightening the world's uncivilized races. Fluttered folk and wild, your new-caught silent peoples, half devil and half child.